At the same time, nationalism began to take hold in the West and spread across many portions of the world. In connection with modern nationalist discourse, history, or appeals to history, became a favorite instrument for claiming territory. The assertion that a particular people resided in a specific land over a long period of time is a key argument in the international discourse over territorial rights. Thus, native and indigenous peoples have rights by virtue of their long-standing association with the land. While Israel's Declaration of Independence does not evoke Abraham's covenant, it declares that the land of Israel was the birthplace of the Jewish people. In pressing secular claims to land, it is these principles and the four put forward by Justice Marshall that are brought before the international bodies that adjudicate disputes over territory. I will make a few brief observations and then elaborate if you have questions. Conquest and purchase are more straightforward, so I will not say more about them except that in the present discourse, conquest is no longer an accepted means for legitimating claims as it was in the 19th century, even if it remains an effective instrument for actually gaining control over territory. Treaties, that is, legal agreements, deserve a brief comment. Although the Arabs of Palestine and the Middle East did not recognize Jewish rights, the League of Nations and the United Nations have done so repeatedly. For example, in 1948, even the United States and Russia, or the Soviet Union, who could agree in little else, voted in favor of partitioning the land into an Arab and a Jewish state. In effect, the breakup of the Ottoman Empire resulted in a number of new states, including Israel, Iraq, Syria, Jordan, and Lebanon. An Arab-Palestinian state would have been created alongside a Jewish Israel in 1948 if the Arabs had only accepted international decisions and ratified the United Nations resolution rather than repeatedly attempt to destroy Israel. The reason the United Nations voted in favor of the partition of Palestine in 1948 was surely political in part, but claims of Jewish rights to a portion of the land were accepted as legitimate because they rested on secular and universal principles. I will comment on two. First, the United Nations considered Jewish claims legitimate by reason of history. Jews were widely recognized as a people who have existed for thousands of years with roots in the Promised Land and despite 2,000 years of exile with a continuous connection with it. Among the few rejecting this were Arab Muslims, who insisted Jews were merely adherents of Judaism, a religious faith, but not a people. This fallacious view has been the claim of the Palestinian Liberation Organization, and it serves a clear political purpose. In the previous century, it was peoples who were granted the rights to a national state. Zionism is one of many such movements for national liberation that marked the 20th century. Thus, denying the status of Jews, the status of a people, is equivalent to denying their right to membership in the family of nations and entitled to a state. Second, Zionism was not a classic Western imperialist movement. Zionists did not exploit local labor or set up a colonial economy. Jews themselves became farmers, builders of cities, and workers in factories. They used their muscle, their sweat, their labor, and their own capital. There was no mother country that gave political support, sent an army, and provided capital for Jewish settlers in exchange for profit. Over the last century, Zionism transformed Palestine from an underpopulated and underdeveloped backwater of the Ottoman Empire into a modern society with an economy equivalent to those found in Western Europe and other developed states. There were only 250,000 inhabitants in all Palestine in 1800, and only 500,000 in 1900, far fewer than lived in the country many centuries ago at the time of Jesus and in the following centuries. The Jews made the largely barren land into a productive country that the Bible described as a land flowing with milk and honey, with a population today of approaching 10 million. unused or underused land may be subject to new ownership, a widely accepted principle reflected in Marshall's writings. Moreover, the historical connection of the people to the land was no mere abstraction. It was real and manifest in the language returning Jews spoke and how they marked the landscape. That is, they gave up the language of the exile and renewed Hebrew as the language of the country. It is the only case in the modern world where an ancient language used primarily in sacred and learned texts has been so recovered and made into a living language used in commerce, politics, science, and in the writing of a modern literature so compelling that it has earned a Nobel Prize. Many Israelis replace diaspora names with those found in the Bible and associated with the land. They did not call their new towns and streets by foreign names associated with the countries of origin. There is no New England, New York, New Oxford, Paris, Berlin, or Moscow in Israel. Like Beersheba or Beersheba in Jerusalem, many sites have existed continuously and carry names that appear in the Bible or associated with Jewish history. The language and the landscape of Israel resonate with renewal, and in this significant way, too, the Zionist enterprise differs from lands colonized by foreign immigrants. These achievements persuaded non-Jews of the legitimacy of the Jewish state in Palestine. In 1922, the League of Nations provided for a mandate for Palestine that explicitly conferred Jews with the right to reconstitute themselves in the land. Indeed, reconstitution became the legal term employed by the world community. The key part of this word is re, which from the Latin means again. Jews were thus empowered to return, to rebuild, and to reclaim the land. The world community did not see Jews as foreigners or conquerors. After 20 centuries of living as a separate people and as strangers in the many lands of the diaspora, the Jews realized their dream of returning to the land promised to Abraham and his descendants. They expended enormous creative energy to reclaim this home and to live in it as natives, speaking the reclaimed Hebrew language. It was this successful reconstitution that so impressed a large proportion of the world community with the vitality and authenticity of the Zionist enterprise and earned international recognition for the legitimacy to the claim to that portion of the country Jews had so distinctively and successfully marked. The reasons for Arab rejection of Israel are difficult to disentangle against this backdrop of widespread acceptance based on secular principles. Hamas and Islamic fundamentalists explicitly reject Israel on theological grounds. But the debate over Palestine in the international community is necessarily expressed in secular terms. This apparent paradox may also hold out some hope. Secular claims may yet offer the most likely means for reaching a compromise over the contested land Jews, Christians, and Muslims consider holy. Even if secular claims and counterclaims are a veneer, masking deeply held religious beliefs, they may still offer a more comfortable place for successful negotiation. Secularism may make more possible the pragmatism necessary for the mutual accommodation so necessary for a contested land holding sacred meaning to so many. Arigato. Thank you.